Good evening, everyone. It's an absolute pleasure to welcome both the panelists and participants today for this webinar titled Career Progression for Freshers. What are the challenges and opportunities in a tough job market? It's very relevant, and we've actually lined up experienced panelists to actually share their perspective from the industry. Let me do a self-introduction and then introduce you to the panelists. This is a part of the Step Up initiative launched by Naukri. The webinar series, this is a ninth series that we've launched. I will touch upon the Step Up initiative, but let me give a brief introduction about myself and then the panelists. I have over 20 years of experience, or 80 quarters of experience, 18 years predominantly with India's largest job site, which is Naukri.com. Predominantly, my job is to actually drive top line growth or revenue growth for the company. Before this, I worked for about 3 years with an engineering firm called the Indian Seamless Group. So largely my experience has been in driving revenue or top line growth for the company. Naukri.com is a part of Info Edge India Limited. We are a listed company. We're the first internet company to be listed in the stock exchange. We're listed in the NSE and the BSE. As I speak today, I mean, when I joined the company was roughly around 10 CR in terms of top line. Today, we are about 1,000 crores in terms of top line. Our market cap is about $5 billion USD as I speak today. So in a nutshell, I mean, you know, we've been pioneers in the internet space in terms of online recruitment. In addition to the other brands that InfoEdge has or runs, we have Shiksha, 99acres, and Jeevan Sathi. So these are the other four brands, or these are the total brands that we run under the InfoEdge umbrella. Now, let me take this opportunity to introduce you to the panel of people who would be sort of assisting, and where we will actually sort of discuss the theme for today's webinar. So let me start with Saurabh. Saurabh, again, is an industry veteran. He's got about 15 years of experience. Currently, he's the executive director HR for Morgan Stanley. He's also worked with companies like JP Morgan and American Express in his last 15 years. So he's going to bring in a rich perspective, a lot of experience he's got with diverse companies. So welcome, Saurabh. I mean, you know. Now we move on to Renita. Renita is the director HR for Emerson India, Emerson R&D. She's got about 15 years of experience, and she's traversed almost all, functions of HR, starting from talent acquisition, talent management, comp and benefit. So her experience in terms of talent management is going to be very relevant in today's discussion. And this 15 years working for a large R&D company like Emerson, I think the learning experience that she would be sharing with the participants, I'm sure is going to be enriching. Now we move on to the third panelist, Geeta. Geeta, again, she's got rich experience in the banking space. When I was actually looking at her profile, I was impressed. She's worked with companies like ANZ, SG, Deutsche Bank, and now she's working for Finastra as India Head HR. She's also a certified level one coach and also is passionate about coaching and volunteers to coach. So welcome, Geeta. Thank so you. These are three industry panelists that we've lined. And now we have somebody from the academic world. Normally what we do is these webinars are typically from the industry perspective and people who actually worked in the industry. But since the theme is about freshers, it's also important for us to get an academic perspective. And some of you who are actually participating in today's show are also people who probably would be graduating maybe in 2021, or some of you would have just graduated. So an academic perspective is very relevant today. And that's where Professor Rajshekar would actually add immense value. He's a senior professor in the Department of Mathematics, Indian Institute of Technology, Kharagpur. He's donned multiple hats. Apart from his teaching, I mean, experience that he has, he was also, he's currently the dean. Planning and coordination. In addition to this, Professor Rajshekar was actually the convener for Placements All India IIT. So he's going to bring in that perspective of how, what are the challenges students would be facing and how institutions like the IITs are actually interfacing with the corporate world, during normal times as well as during times of crisis like this. So, before we deep dive into the topic, I wanted to sort of also touch upon this theme, the Step Up initiative. The webinar series that we're launching, I mean, this is the ninth series that we've launched, is a part of the Step Up initiative. So essentially, the Step Up initiative is basically our initiative both to actually help companies as well as employees. Companies which are actually in the forefront, which are actually fighting the COVID war. So companies in the pharmaceutical space, industries which are in the healthcare domain, companies which are in the manufacturing of medical equipments and medical devices, and hospitals. So we are helping them hire. In fact, most of the services that we're offering to these industry verticals are free of cost. Of course, they have to be consumed within a time bound or a time frame. In addition to this, what we're also doing is we're also helping job seekers discover jobs through the Step Up initiative. So the Step Up initiative is basically a banner which you can actually see on the homepage of Naukri. When you click that, you're actually taken to a landing page. Essentially, while the number of jobs on the platform has reduced post the pandemic, I mean, we had almost about 5 lakh jobs on the platform, and currently it's about 4.5 lakh jobs. But it would help the job seekers discover jobs quickly. So typically companies which are actively hiring, what we've actually done is put them on the Step Up. We have a microsite or a landing page. So people can actually access these jobs at one click of the mouse, number one. The other thing that we're doing with job seekers is, of course, skill and grow. A lot of companies today want certifications. So we've actually created a lot of content around certification. Some of them are free, some of them are paid, some of them are subsidized. So job seekers can actually use the, time available with them to actually sort of upskill. And last but not the least, what we also do is people who are probably laid off or people who probably have lost their jobs, we have a section where, you can go and update your profile on Naukri, and you can actually sort of tag your CV as somebody who's immediately available. And for recruiters, when they actually do a search, essentially they get to see these CVs, and it also improves your own, employment with companies. So these are stuff that we're doing. And the webinar series is basically we get thought leaders from the industry and they share their experience, because a lot of them have actually seen, multiple downturns. So their experience is going to sort of at least be reassuring for people. So the webinar series that we've actually launched is also one of the, programs under the Step Up initiative. So that's the broad spectrum of service that we actually offer under the Step Up initiative. And now let me not sort of, let's get going to the topic of the day, which is basically career progression for freshers. So while I would want, sort of inputs from practitioners here, because it's going to be reassuring for people who are actually logging in into the show. What I would want to know is from all of you, Saurabh, Geeta and Renita, what is happening in your respective organizations with respect to fresher hiring? While we take this question to the panelists, what we're also doing is we're also running a live poll on Facebook. So people who are actually the participants can actually sort of, in case they have an offer in hand, what is the status with your offer? You can actually sort of attempt to actually give your answers there. So basically there are about 3 or 4 questions, we are sort of asking you, have you got onboarded? Have you got, what is the status with your joining? So this is a poll which is happening, and I'll sort of reveal the outcome of the poll as we get into further discussions. Over to you, Saurabh. I would like to sort of hear from you what's happening with Morgan Stanley and your commitment to freshers.
Thank you so much, Manoj. I should say thank you, Naukri, for giving me the opportunity to appear on this panel. It's really nice to be here and be able to interact with such a large audience. Manoj, to answer your question very quickly, I think we've been very fortunate that the senior leadership of Morgan Stanley had very early perceived the situation that was evolving due to COVID. We had planned to make sure that our commitment to all the campus offers and fresher offers that we intended to make were honored for 2020. So I think what we got from senior management was that once the COVID situation was clear, and these are very, really unprecedented times, nobody could have predicted how this situation will evolve starting February. I think it was just about execution, because as a firm, we were convinced that we need to make sure that we honor all our commitments. It was only a matter of how are we going to execute on the commitments that we've made. And I think that's an ongoing process as we speak, because we are learning new things every day as an organization as well. Thank you.
Great talk. Can we have Renita?
Yeah, sure. Good evening, everyone. And to begin with, I would say this year, we have been a little low on the campus hires right from the beginning. But then as an organization, all the offers that were rolled out itself, they have all been honored. In some cases, there have been 3-month delays in joining, but clearly those are solid joiners that will come in. And in some cases also, when we are seeing that there is a delay in joining, it's also because some of the candidates are not able to travel back from their hometown because of the situation here. So to ensure everybody comes in together at the right time, and organizations like the office facilities are also not totally opened up. So to ensure all of that is streamlined, there have been certain delays, but otherwise all the offers are being definitely honored. Yeah.
That's great. Reassuring, at least for people who are on the show. Great to hear that. Geeta, what is the status with Finistra?
So first of all, good evening to all of you. It's really exciting to see a lot of you already having, you know, like 31 questions and so many more chats. So it seems like it's a very active group. So nice to be amongst all of you. So from a Finistra's perspective, we have offered a lot of people last year, and we've honored all the offer. Indeed, there was a time where we were, you know, kind of going back and checking with the candidates, you know, if they are sure to join, because those are commitments which was already made, and we honored that. And also from the business perspective, the business that we are in itself is very different, where it's banking products. So pretty much it is recurring business. So there won't be like a big daunting damage that would be done because of COVID. But that said, I'm not saying we are the only organization, we are thriving or whatever. We have our own challenges. But then from a freshers hiring, nothing changes. In fact, as we are talking, we are still looking at, you know, how many freshers do we need for the next year and so on. So, yeah, I mean, if there's anything that you have to catch from this conversation of what I am saying, definitely the freshers hiring doesn't stop. We are still hiring and continue to honor all the offers that we have rolled out last year.
You know, I think this is really reassuring, at least, you know, three large companies sort of reassuring candidates that at least their commitment stands good is definitely reassuring. So let me sort of, you know, as a follow-up question on this, there are companies, I mean, the best situation is you had an offer and then, you know, companies are actually sort of, honoring them. But there are a lot of people out there who probably currently do not have an offer in hand. How should they go about in their job discovery process? How should they actually connect with recruiters? Because I'm sure a lot of them, the moment they leave the campus, then, you know, the handholding from the campus is actually almost over, because campuses would then start focusing on the next year's batch. So, I mean, you know, any tips, any suggestions, I think that would sort of also help people who are actually in their discovery process. So can we have your perspective on this, Geeta? Sure. And maybe another perspective from Renita could also help.
Okay, sure. So to start off with, yes, you know, campus hiring is something which, like you said, it's a handheld process, and, you know, people know what to talk, who are the organization which are coming. There's a lot of homework that is done. But apart from that, I also know that there are, you know, groups of universities which also gather together and do campus recruitment. So that is one of the avenues that I would suggest. Apart from that, I think, the kids who are coming now, we're all digital native, so they exactly know what to do, given you have your, you know, some of the platforms where you can go and connect with all the recruiters and so on. Even now, I see a lot of the students from the college who reach out to me, my recruiters, everyone saying, hey, this is what we are thinking. So I think people kind of know where to go to and, you know, have to get some of their work done. So my recommendation generally would be, if you exactly know which organization you want to work for, or you already have a lead as to, you know, that there is some hiring that's happening, then, you know, tread on the path of some of the contacts that you have, or, you know, and I'm sure a lot of universities definitely have the networking contacts with large organizations. So utilize all of them. From Finister's perspective, we're always looking for fresh talent, because we believe, you know, the organization pyramid is something that we have to always, you know, keep watching. So from that perspective, we always have to get a lot of freshers at the bottom of the rung. And so that doesn't change for us. And hence, it keeps moving. And yeah, digital is the way we are going. So that's my suggestion.
Okay. Great.
Yeah. I'd like to, so thanks, Geeta. Actually, I echo all the points that you're mentioning. We are in the age of information. Everybody has got a lot of information, different avenues to get the information. So it's all there. But one important point I would also want to make here is that the method of job search has considerably changed over the years. Earlier it would be like you would make one resume and go, you know, give it in door to door, or maybe, you know, send it as an email everywhere. And I've done that. So that was the job search, that this is my resume, please fit it in whichever position you have. But now it is a lot more different. It's a more focused search. It is important for all the candidates. Everybody has a unique skill, a requirement, an aspiration, a kind of a role that they want to play. So first identifying that, identifying which industry you want to work in, which are the organizations you want to work in, or which is the skill set that you would like to pursue as your first step or the next few steps. So you identify those things, then use the information that's available, use all the avenues that are there, find out what are those organizations looking for, upgrade yourself if you have the time within. Prepare your CV. So in this competitive age or competitive world that we have, every position has so many applications. It's important for you to stand out. So that's one of the things that people can work on. Job seekers must try to build a CV for a job, and then going to a recruiter saying that, hey, that's the job that I'm interested in, and here's my profile for it. So that makes it much easier and definitely a higher success ratio for job search, I would say.
Okay, great. So the other question that comes to, you know, my mind is, what are the skill sets that freshers should actually sort of, you know, invest in so that they're more employable? This is both for Professor as well as, you know, Renita again. And also, you know, if I were to sort of ask you, which are the areas where you see that, you know, hiring is going to actually, you know, take place, or where the absorption is going to happen? So one, of course, is the skills, which are the skills that they should be focusing on to actually improve their employability. The other stuff is, where are the areas where you see, I mean, you know, there's going to be hiring for freshers.
Okay, so can I go first?
So
I would say more from the technology front, I would definitely say that the technical skills that people have gained, and I'm saying technology, but it could be any skill that the freshers have, you know, studied on. With those skills, they need to, as I said, find out which is the area or which is the industry that they could work on. But the skills that they will need to work on is how to utilize that and apply that in my work. So traditional technical skills are never going out of fashion. You could say the mechanical engineering, the electrical engineering, instrumentation, software development, embedded development, digital analytics, business intelligence. So these things will definitely, they will always be there. And those jobs will never go away. The organize, like as much as job seekers need jobs, the organizations need the freshers to come in. Right. So it's a mutual need, and that will continue to happen. However, one important thing is, particularly for freshers, during the interview, how much will you ask and what will you ask for knowledge? What usually recruiters say, and I'm sure my fellow panelists will agree, is the competencies that you will build. What are, from a fresher, you would want to see whether they have that nimble learning attitude. Do they have that confidence when they are speaking up? Are they willing to take, are they situationally adaptable? So there are many times where these are things like if a interview is rescheduled or it is delayed, how does the candidate, you know, relate to those? So more than just the technical skills or what you have studied, it's also the behavioral skills that people see when you are hiring at this level. So that's what I would add.
Oh, great. Professor, I mean, your point of view on this?
Yeah, good evening, everyone. This is definitely challenging in this scenario for the freshers. So when you say skill set, we call it hands-on. First, be hands-on. When I say hands-on, typically people are carried away by various buzzwords, and then people say, what are you interested in? People say machine learning and blah, blah. But first, you get to know what is machine learning. Do some small mini projects. If you never got an opportunity before, now you try and have a little bit of hands-on on those so that you can show it to the organization when you get an opportunity. And also when you're having a project as part of the curriculum, many times what we do within the scope, we do some component and then leave it. So now try to take it a little further, make it conversions as a demo or a small prototype kind of, if you have an opportunity. And another skill set that you require in this scenario is an integration skill. When I say an integration skill, some people require, let us say, only they're limited to coding and developing, but maybe the current scenario is expecting a single person to completely have some hands-on with hardware and then integration so that at one point things are done. So I think you have to have some skill set at an interface you have to develop. That is very much required in my opinion. And of course, how you take the interview is very, people say when the question is asked, then you just answer and then keep quiet. That's not the way. You take some points from there and then move further. So that kind of confidence you have to develop. Yeah.
Great. Saurav and Geeta, any point of view here?
Yeah, I was almost jumping to say, can I?
Sure, Geeta, so, go first.
I think, thanks, Professor. It was nice to hear what you're saying because, you know, that's what we still tell people, you know, even at work in our office as well. We say, when you learn something, try and apply and so on. So if you ask me, I think as, you know, so, as people who are coming out of the universities, you already have the academic knowledge and probably that is why you are even eligible to apply for a job. And that was why some of the organizations pick you as well. But some of the differentiator really is the learnability. I borrow on what Rita said. The learnability is really, really important, and the thought process, because sometimes if you look at it, it's not about giving the right answer or giving the right solution, but it's just about the thought process of, you know, from where are you coming to, you know, respond to this. Some of the technical assessments that we have as well are designed in such a way that we are not expecting you to exactly give the right answer to it. It's just about what's the thought process you're applying, you know, so that we know, okay, this is a thought process, then it's more in a growth mindset kind of thought process. So it's really bringing your individual self is the differentiator apart from the academic knowledge that you have. Thanks so much.
Great, Geeta. Sorry.
I'm going to latch on to what Geeta said, bring your individual sense to work. But look, I've been making some notes from what Professor Rajasekhar said, what Rita started. And if I can, you know, just try and summarize on behalf of, you know, the points that we've heard, you have to bring your 100% to the table all the time, right? What I think, and Professor Sir, correct me if I'm wrong, you need to apply yourself means you don't just get the academic knowledge, you need to put it into practice. It doesn't matter what industry you're working in, but technology, if is your forte, then you have to figure out how technology works at that industry. If you get into an interview, how are you presenting yourself? And all of this will come with a central belief that no matter what happens, I have to be at my 100% all the time. I think that's a fundamental differentiator between people. The situation that we're in, and it's only a situation, it's a period of time, right? It's going to go away. We just don't know when. So what people need to ask themselves is, am I competing with someone else because we're all in the same situation, or am I competing with myself to get better, as what Renita said, get better at what I'm doing? Can I make sure I do more than what is expected? And that will show in your interviews. So always bring your 100% to any table that you're presenting yourself at.
Great. So this is a more futuristic question to you, Saurabh. What's your sense? I mean, you know, when are we seeing things returning back to normal, or the new normal is this? I mean, you know, I know it's slightly futuristic, but given the experience, and you've also seen the financial meltdown in 2008. And so I'm sure, I mean, you know, you have a perspective on this. So hence thought of, you know, not leaving you, but how do you see this sort of playing out? When do you see this sort of getting back to normal, if at all it gets back to normal?
Sure. So fortunately or unfortunately, I've been part of these experiences. When I was starting my career, we had the September 11 attacks, and then global economy took a downturn. So that happened when I was just stepping into trying to look for a job after my bachelor's degree in economics. And then when I joined Morgan Stanley, that's when the global financial crisis happened. So I had not even completed my probation, and I was thinking about, you know, what happens if I lose my job. And now this is happening. I think the safe assumption here is that there will be upheavals in life. Something or the other will keep happening. You know, just to answer your question as to where we are with the COVID situation and when things get better, I don't think anybody knows the answer. Right? It's like asking what's going to be the stock market January 1st, 2021. If anybody says they know, then I wouldn't believe them, because we really don't know what's going to happen. So rather than thinking about what the situation, how it's going to unfold, whether we will get a vaccine, whether we will go back to normal, we should be thinking about what is it that I can do in this situation? How do I adapt to this environment, because this period is going to get over, but your life is going to extend beyond just this period. So I think focusing on the controllables is much more important than thinking about when is this period going to end. Thank you.
Okay. And what are your plans for the 2021 hiring? I mean,
I think it's difficult to say at the moment. I'll be very honest. Our focus at the moment is making sure that the interns and full-time hires that we've had from campus this year, they have a great experience. And everybody is operating in a virtual mode. So how can we integrate our new hires into the firm? Do they understand what Morgan Stanley is all about, right? Do they understand their jobs better? We are no longer in a situation where you can sit with your manager or with your colleagues over a cup of coffee and get to know each other. So how do you assimilate culture and top talent into the organization? I think that's been our focus, and I think that's going to remain our focus for the next few months. We're clearly not at a stage where we can predict what 2021 looks like. You know, our focus is more about giving people a world-class experience that are joining Morgan Stanley now.
Okay. So, I mean, just for the information of all the participants, so the poll is going to be live. So you can actually sort of take the poll. Essentially, what we're asking is, I mean, you know, what's happening with your offer? Have you got onboarded, or have companies sort of revoked the offer, or they've sort of deferred the joining? Or last but not the least, situation is, companies are not responding to your questions. So this is what we will want response from the participants. Most of them are, people who have offers, but the employers are not responding. I think 61% of people who've taken the polls are actually sort of saying that. So 34% are people who have actually got the offer and they've actually joined. So that's a happy situation to be in. There are about 15% where there's deferral or there is a delay in the joining date. So you're still better off. And the worst, or probably, I mean, you know, the not so happy situation is about 13% where they're saying the offer rollout they've actually sort of called back their offer. So that's what, at least from the participants who've actually taken the poll, that's the sense that we're getting. So Professor, let me ask you this question. I mean, you know, because you also interact a lot with, I mean, you know, the corporate world. What is the sense that you're gathering? And also you have experience of running the placement cell. You were the convener for All India Placements IIT. So that's a fair representation. And I'm sure, I mean, you know, in your interaction with the industry, what are you getting to hear? I mean, you know, in terms of, I mean, our company sort of telling you some line of sight in terms of when are they planning to sort of hire or what are they doing? So over to you, Professor.
Manoj, for this question, in particular, in this scenario, to answer, just late in the March, we figured out that we have to be very quick on this. So we have constituted a campus placement task force. And by virtue of this, we have been communicating to the recruiters and we have informed them well ahead of time our revised calendars, academic calendar, and indicated to them when the students will be available for them to be on board. So this is one step we have done. And also on behalf of All IIT Placement Committee, we have sent communications to the recruiters and appealed them not to revoke. And it's a long lasting relation with our recruiters. So they responded very positively. And at least whatever I could gather, the situation is very much comfortable. And that's what so far,
Okay, at least that's good to know. The other thing is, I mean, you know, when we are actually, you know, sort of operating like this, the recruitment process itself is going to actually go through a lot of change. I mean, you know, campus recruitment in the past was, you had teams where you had specialists who would actually sort of map campuses, who would actually, you know, go there. It's a full year season. I mean, there's a calendar. I mean, you know, MBA, graduations, I mean, engineering, non-engineering. I mean, each of these, I mean, different universities have different, you know, timelines. And there's a big, at least in the IT services space, I know there's a lot of, you know, teams which actually work on campus placement itself. So now, you know, I mean, when companies are actually moving virtual, what I would like to know from practitioners is, how are you actually tweaking your own recruitment process? Because I think unlike, I mean, you know, you flying down to locations and campuses, at least till, you know, this pandemic sort of, we don't see a vaccine, I think, you know, it sort of will remain like this for some time. So what are the tweaks that you're doing in terms of your own recruitment processes, number one? And a follow-up question is, what is the stuff that, candidates will need to be sort of be conscious about? Because when you're actually sort of in a face-to-face interview, it's very different. And when you're actually doing something in a virtual platform, it's very different. So how should candidates sort of prepare themselves as well as organizations? How are you actually sort of tweaking your own respective hiring processes when you're actually moving virtual? Over to you, Geeta.
Sure. So definitely one fun piece that we will miss is, you know, going to these universities and meeting these kids. That used to be like really the fun bit. So we are going to miss that. But that said, you know, I think we've risen to the occasion when suddenly COVID happened. I don't think any of us had planned saying, if COVID happens, this is what I'm going to do in the next few weeks, right? None of us knew. All the organization rose up to the occasion. Probably some of them did in 2 days, some of them did it in 2 weeks, but all of us are out here. So that said, thanks to all this, you know, the new technologies that has come into place, your AI, your machine learning, where all of them, where suddenly all of this was coming up and, you know, people were like, what's going to happen to the jobs? And now is the situation. So we are going to, I mean, from a finance perspective, we are going to have everything digital, you know, including our assessments, technical assessments, and the HR interviews, the discussion that we will be having, I mean, our panelists will be having, all of that is going to be digital. And that said, for the students, what they should really be careful of, not careful, they should be wary of is there is no difference for you, either you do it in person or digital. You're just going to be yourself. And I think that's what is really important. And I'm sure some of us get a little conscious in front of the camera and so on. But I think you should really credit yourself with the academic knowledge that you bring to the table. And that will be the differentiator. And of course, you know, from a risk and an audit perspective, some of the things that we have set up, which I think any organization which is doing online as technical assessments will have, like when you're responding to some of the technical questions or coding, you got to really look at the computer or just be doing it and not have like a huge gap, or, you know, anything which is an anomaly should not occur. Because that is what the AI and the ML kind of technologies are going to tell us. Hey, you know what? This guy did the assessment for a 30 minutes assessment. He did it in 12 minutes. You know, that is like, you know, it's definitely an antenna. Or somebody who should have done in 30 minutes, like 10 times he looked off the screen. So unfortunately, you put all of that in place, fortunately or unfortunately. But those are things I'm sure all of you already know, but those are some of the measures that we have put in place. Just to, you know, for the organization perspective, just we want to be sure that we're getting the right people, and for you to be really confident to know that, yes, you've done all the right things to get into the organization, so that, you know, later, neither of us are worried as to, oh my God, who did we get in, or where did I join? That moment wouldn't occur because of this. So that is for that's from the organization perspective, and for the students who are applying for the jobs.
Saurabh, do you want to sort of come in here?
Yeah, I think Geeta has covered a lot of this. So thanks, Geeta, for actually sharing your perspective. I've actually made notes of what when Geeta was talking. This is quite useful. I think like Geeta said, the fundamentals that we are looking for from a capability or competency standpoint are not changing. But what's going to change is the way you are approaching a conversation or an interview. So, Geeta mentioned this, right? There are some people who are very uncomfortable in front of a camera. Is that a skill that you need to develop, right? We used to talk about how can you present yourself better when you meet somebody for the first time, right? Or do you have an elevator pitch? Can you explain your career trajectory in 30 seconds? But those opportunities are not there. So we're replacing those with things like Zoom etiquettes, right? Even if you're in a Zoom call, are you dressed properly, right? Are you maintaining the decorum? So there is a new set of etiquettes that are coming through. And what I mean in general, what I'm trying to say is that the skills need to be adaptable because situations will change over a period of time. Who knows, we may just go back to the new normal and Zoom may not be as exciting as it is right now, but the situations will change. So your skills need to be adaptable because the fundamentals are still the same. We're still looking for, high performing, strong academic background people with a great energy, intensity, and attitude to start their careers. I hope that answers your question. Thank you.
Great, thanks. Renita, any thoughts?
Yeah, I think most of the points are covered, but I would definitely say it's still the basic thing continues to be integrity, being very honest and open at the time of interview. At times, what corporates believe is that if we don't get the right candidate, like Geeta was mentioning, if somebody is looking here and there five times while answering, it could be you're taking help. It's fine to take help. There's no trouble in taking help, but that will take you just that far. It's not going to be a long-term success. If people later get to know that you didn't actually know it, it doesn't show very well later. So being very open, being honest, and as Saurabh mentioned, you know, being practice it. Practice makes a person perfect, right? So practice it, just record yourself answering a very good question, the question of your choice, and see what you did wrong. See where your expression was not right and then correct it. So, you know, those things can help maybe in the virtual or the new way of interviewing.
Great. So, Professor, again, coming back to you, Professor Rajshekar, what are you doing in terms of, things are very different now. So what are you doing in terms of ensuring that students don't get impacted?
Yeah, in fact, a couple of weeks back, we already started gearing up for the next session. So typically, as you know, the placement season starts in the month of, from 1st December and internship end of August. That's a curriculum. But slightly, we may change it, but with regard to internships, but with regard to the placements, still we are hopeful that we can have December session. We are hopeful. So we are gearing up. We are identifying our student coordinators and then counseling them, asking them how to work remotely. Earlier, a bunch of students used to sit at our CDC and work on. So now they have to work remotely for some time. So we are counseling them how can they communicate with the companies, and then how can they bring them on board with us so that the JNFs are filled and all those stuff. And from curriculum point of view, definitely there will be a lot of online teaching. So there will be also for students some sort of counseling, and how they, whatever the laboratories they're going to miss, how they can compensate. So these are the brainstorming sessions happening, and I'm sure we'll be definitely be successful even with the laboratories by creating a lot of virtual laboratories and train them. And whenever we have an immediate opportunity, we bring them physically and then have them laboratories, because a practical training is very useful, in particular from job perspective. So there is a lot of brainstorming happening. Yeah, we are working on it.
Okay. What we will also do is, because there are a lot of questions which are coming in, so we will also take some questions before we get into the Q&A. Any final piece of advice because to freshers, especially, I mean, you know, from industry veterans, and of course, I'll get in the professor also to give his perspective, because I mean, day in, day out, they interact with students. Please.
Maybe with them first?
Yeah, please, you can go ahead.
Okay, so I think the industry scenario is going to be very dynamic. When I say dynamic, a particular X company which was having certain portfolios may jump in now with a changing scenario, acquire different portfolios. So therefore, the freshers should not map a company versus the portfolios in their mind. They should analyze properly and have a good pool of companies in their bag so that they can apply. And the second one is, all along they were definitely under peer pressure. So this is one occasion the peers should take care of them. So the freshers should think and then try to identify their real interest. This is a great opportunity for them, and explore various opportunities in an area where they are really dreaming about. So this is one thing. And another thing is, recently Government of India had announced Atmanirbhar Bharat. So if you connect that, I'm sure there are a lot of small scale industries are coming up, they are being supported, and the manufacturing sector also will be popping up in a big way. So I think sitting at a comfort zone, you should explore these possibilities, figure out where you would fit in. So that's very important.
That's very important. Thank you. Thanks, Professor. Over to you, all of you. I mean, you can choose the order in which you want to answer.
If I can go first, second. So I think, as applicants, I'm sure you will be very anxious and ambitious as well, I'm sure. If not, I'll be worried. But given the market dynamics, I think you just got to alter that to, you know, what the market is, because a couple of years ago, you being ambitious, the market was perfect, so it's all great. But then the market is moving a little bit, so just alter your aspirations as well so that you're not let down. So, and this market is something which has gone up, come down, and it's never going to be stable. So if you can, you know, kind of accept that reality and still be in the job, in the job market, I think you'll enjoy looking for jobs, because it's just not a corporate jobs, right, that you will really land on and say, hey, I've got a job. For example, I don't know, was it one of the IIT guys? Maybe you all have seen this WhatsApp or that little video which is doing its rounds, that Professor Janaki or Teacher Janaki thing. It was just one of them, like you guys, who just, you know, picked it up, and it is doing such a big round in the WhatsApp. So instead of being stressed about, oh my God, what am I going to do? Will I get a job? Yes, all of you will mostly get the job. But look at if there are any other aspirations that you have for yourself, and also start nurturing it. And definitely don't stop learning. That is something which is really, really important. Just because you finish your academics does not mean, okay, you're done and dusted with everything. So don't stop learning, because life doesn't stop teaching. That's from me.
Great, Geeta. Can we have Saurav?
Sure. I think my advice is going to be very, very simple. Stay calm, stay positive, because this is just a period in your life. And like everything else before this, this too shall pass. So if you keep a positive attitude and stay calm, you'll be fine. Thank you.
Renita.
Yep. And I must say, very beautifully said, Professor. You know, you said the peers should take care of each other and all of that. I so relate to it. I mean, at this point, all organizations are also talking to each other so much. We are all taking care of each other. At this point, I do see it. And Geeta and Saurabh also very, very well said. I would just, because I'm the last among this group, I would definitely try to summarize it saying that if you have the right knowledge, your skills and your competencies, nothing can stop you from getting the right opportunity. So think about it, be positive, as Saurabh mentioned, and there will be an opportunity to think and get to the right opportunity.
Great, thank you. Now let's get into the Q&A, because there are a lot of questions, 188, 199 questions already. So let me sort of take some of them now. And, you know, I think some of you can actually sort of answer them. I mean, there's no order of sequence, but if you're comfortable answering them, then, you know, you could volunteer and then go ahead. So the first question from one of the participants is, what are the common skills that employers look, irrespective of, I mean, you know, whichever job you're actually applying. So basically, they want to know what are the kind of skills which is universal. I mean, you know, which people will generally look. Of course, you have an area of specialization, but beyond the area of specialization, what are the common skills people look for? Is the first question.
Rinita had actually touched upon this, but I'm just going to, you know, draw parallels from there. So, like I said, academics is a given, but I think the other skills is really about, you know, the ownership. Like, you know, if you take up something, you got to ensure you close it, and commitment. And when I call out all these words, it's really from a very corporate scenario perspective, because in today's work environment, that has been the biggest challenge. Yes, everybody gets so much of work to do, but then getting that to a closure, right? So ownership, accountability, and, you know, and also especially in this time, it's also about, you know, having each other's back, which is really important. And like I've always been saying, probably have said more than once here, the learning attitude, right? Because yes, there is, and I've also seen some of the interns when they come, they say, hey, you know, I'm specialized in this. I will want to do only this. I mean, I think that is going to be a derailer. Yes, you come, you have a lot of background of what you studied, but if there are opportunities to learn something else in the organization, just pick up and do, because that is where you will be really able to, probably, you know, it'll just click somewhere. In fact, we have in the current organization that I am in, we've had somebody who was an EA. For a couple of years, she was helping somebody doing a BA job, a business analyst job. And this time we said, oh, you know what? I don't think she should be doing an executive assistant job. She's so good in BA. So it's about also, you know, garnering whatever comes your way and looking at what works.
Yeah. I'd like to just add on what Geeta just mentioned. The learning agility, how quickly you can learn. And the most important thing, it's a very commonly used term, but the communication skills. If you have all the skills and all the knowledge that you have, but you can't just say it correctly, that's where, you know, things go wrong. And just to give the perspective of the interviewers, we as HR professionals get responses from our technical panels that the candidate doesn't know the fundamentals of this. So brush up on the fundamentals. So those are some of the things that, you know, come into the picture. So those should help getting a job much easier. Those are skills that you need to communicate well.
Saurabh, any input from you?
Just one quickly. And again, I'm only adding to what Geeta and Renita have said, the ability to be resilient, to be in something for the long haul, to not give up. I think those are inherent traits that if you build in your life, not just in your job, it will easily reflect in your job. So financial resiliency, mental resiliency, professional resiliency, and it again boils down to what Geeta was saying, upskilling yourself all the time. I think if you are inherently a resilient individual, it will show in your professional career.
Great. Well, this is another interesting one. I mean, you know, this question is, I have, how do you manage your career gap conversations? I mean, you know, if you don't have a job right now, is it a taboo? It's very relevant because a lot of them, I mean, you know, may not find a job quickly. So how do you manage this? And what kind of, I mean, you, because you've actually interviewed and you've also seen a lot of candidates in the last, whatever, 15, 20 years. How do you actually manage this? And is this a taboo? Because that's, again, another thing which a lot of people, you know, ask why this gap is there. So that's another, I mean, it's a very interesting question. And I'm sure a lot of people, you know, who are panelists, I'm sorry, who are participants here, will actually sort of go through this. So, so let's sort of just get this. How are these career gap conversations? How one should be managing this?
So probably 10 to 15 years ago, if there was a career gap, there was a typical question saying, you know, what were you doing in the gap? Why was the gap? So the entire context of the interview would go in the gap, right? But I think times are changing. Times are definitely changing. And now, if you look at, like, you know, what I was saying, like how, you know, the candidates are looking for a job, organizations also are also looking for candidates. You won't believe some of the organizations pretty much have, like, you know, some of the categories saying, for these jobs, I want someone who can join like in 1 week's time. So, you know, that taboo is actually moving off, but it's not gone off completely because there are a lot of them who come from the old school of thoughts as well. But it is definitely changing. And also, especially in the gap, what's happening off late is nobody's, I mean, just sitting idly in those gaps. They have reasons, right? They had a family stuff going on. They had, you know, they had to help somebody in the family or they had to travel. And hence, you know, there are reasons to elaborate on why the gap was. And I think organizations have also become mature enough to recognize that, right? Because I know for a fact there is an organization where they give career break leaves, like, you know, where people can take a 6 months off and they can just go on a vacation and then come back and start over there. So, you know, because organizations know that we can no longer say if you're in this company for 10 years, you can't take off or we will not give you those big leaves and so on. So, and a lot of them by choice just, you know, kind of have a little gap in the career. And also with changing times, the gig working economy is going to be the one in the future, right? I think you would already see that a lot of them are not going to be like doing this 5 years, 10 years chunk of work. It's all going to be like, you know, I do this project. I really like this project. Okay, I'm done. What's the next project? And because that's how the candidate market is. And hence, as organization, we are also thinking, oh my God, we got to, you know, adjust to the candidate's market. We can't be saying, I want you to stay with us for 10 years. I mean, it'll be great. But, you know, so the organization is also changing their thought process to say, all right, then I'll have to cater to this kind of people as well. And yeah, so that is what is happening in the market, if that helps.
Great job. Other perspectives from Renita, Saurav?
I saw Saurav and Renita constantly saying yes.
Yeah, I mean, I completely echo what Geeta had mentioned. I think to address this question now is, it's an accepted reality in the industry. You just have to be honest. You have to tell people what that break was. In fact, we have a program in Morgan Stanley that actually encourages people, men and women, who have taken a break to apply to the firm. So the industry has really turned on a dime and is now appreciating people who want to come back into the workforce. The point that Geeta made about the gig economy is extremely relevant, because that's how the workforce philosophy is going to change. And nobody's going to talk about breaks because everybody's going to have breaks. In fact, I'm now thinking maybe, you know, 5 years down the line, Renita, Geeta, and I can share candidates and say, X person is completing the project, you have something for them. And that would, again, what Professor Sir said, look out for each other, make sure we have, you know, collective value being built in the industry, and everybody wins.
I almost thought Saurav was saying, maybe I will go for a break.
I would love to. I would love to. In fact, I'm negotiating with my better half to see if I can get a break.
I have 2 points to add here. One is that when you go for an interview with a thought that this gap is going to be considered a taboo, it will come out very clearly, because people who are interviewing you can read your mind a little bit. I mean, give that much credit to the interviewers. So that's one. And the other point I would say is during the gap, even if you had a gap, what develop yourself? What did you do to upgrade yourself? If you have a decent even enough answer, which you can justify for yourself, it'll come out very clearly. And that works positive, in fact. That many times it does work very positively.
I'll echo what Professor. Most of the freshers, when they get a gap, what happens? All along, we have been only studying to perform good at examinations, but brushing up fundamentals, that is one thing which is lacking. So I think the freshers, if they are expecting a gap and they're not able to succeed, crack a job, they should spend a reasonable good amount of time on brushing up fundamentals and connecting with the real world applications. And also these days, a lot of online certification courses evolve, and they should do in a meaningful way so that they can, end of the day, when the interviewer is asking, they can give a complete justified picture of that.
Great, Professor. Professor, I want you to sort of hold on, because this is very relevant since you see a lot of students. One question which has come here is how to remain positive in this fearful and stressful environment?
Okay.
I think this is not a question just for students. It's for all of
us. All of us. First thing is, you have to understand first yourself. Do not just carried away by the lot of pressure. No, like what is my relatives are expecting about me? What is my extended family? So don't think of those things, and have a lot of self-faith in you. Okay, so that is very important, and make a plan. Okay, so this is going to be there for another 2 months at least. So what can I do constructive? So make a plan for yourself, for developing your personality, developing your communication skills, etc. So this is very much required. Okay, and if you are emotionally little going down, what you can do is you can have some group of bunch of students together, pull up, and they can have some mock interviews, communications, because you are losing physical interaction. So therefore you have to compensate it. So you have to build up such teams and keep alive. Instead of hanging on with the films, etc., you have to be a little more constructive, go a little beyond. That's what I would advise. Okay, yeah.
Thank you very much.
I'd like to add one point over here, and I'm sure Professor will agree. Whether it's positive thinking or negative thinking, it's a spiral. So you need to just tell yourself that at all times. If I think positive, there'll be more positive. If I think negative, like quicksand, daldal bolte hai na. So it's like that. You think negative, it will just keep going negative. You'll get more thoughts of negative, and then you'll see everybody around you talking negative only. So you don't have a choice to be negative. So yeah, be positive.
Great. Any other thoughts from others?
No, I think the points that they've mentioned is great.
Okay. So now, this is again, I mean, you know, how to create a best impression while approaching recruiters online for jobs now?
Okay, so I think instead of, you know, just going on one of those portals and say, hey, I'm looking for a job, I think, you know, if you can kind of bring to the table what's the differentiator that you are bringing, I think that will be something which will be interested for the recruiter as well. Honestly, let me tell you, being recruiters, people get so many emails and messages and calls, but how do you stand out, right? I mean, there are a lot of candidates that I have seen where they really put up their skill set to say, hey, you know what, I know this organization is doing this thing, but I have, you know, this is what I bring to the table, and this is where we can synergize. You won't believe, sometimes maybe we don't have a job for them, but we still would like to stay connected with them to see if there's any, you know, if there's any way that we can be engaging with those candidates. So then, you know, then becoming one among a lot of them, create your unique identification and put the best part of you in front of the recruiters. Again, like, honestly, every recruiter, when they're looking for candidates, they are looking at it with the intention of, I want to close it with the right candidate. So no one is looking at all the candidates saying, I don't want to hire them, right? So that is another thing you should understand. None of the recruiters are up there to not hire because their job is to hire. And it is about, you know, how you are being different than the rest of them. Sometimes you may not be like, you know, 9.5 CGPA on 10, but then the way you present yourself, the way you present your use case, or the way you kind of explain what you've done, articulation, you know, all of this really plays a huge role after academics, if I may say.
I think for me, succinct communication is extremely important. Given that we are now approaching the world through the windows of, you know, a laptop or a desktop or on phone calls, long emails with descriptions take away way too much time. And like Geeta said, we don't want to lose any good candidates. So work on how you are going to present your skills and abilities in the best possible way to a potential recruiter. That's extremely important. If you can build that ability to communicate your message quickly and with impact, I think it goes a long way. You know, one of the things that I learned early in the HR career is the intent of a resume is only to get an interview. But a lot of people spend so much time building long resumes, giving descriptions, that it's very difficult to go beyond the second or the third, or even sometimes the fourth page. I can see Rinita smiling because I'm sure we've all had these experiences. So, you know, if I can share a simple rule that I've always followed, if you have 10 years of experience, you should have a one-page resume. If you have more than 10 years of experience, then you can go into potentially a second page. And that works comes in really good stead because it gives an opportunity to a recruiter to look at your profile quickly, especially for freshers and campus grads. Thank you.
Very interesting. Renita, anything else from your end?
No, I think this is good. It's strange that, you know, you need to tell everything about yourself, your life, your learnings that you've studied so hard for so many years in just half an hour or 1 hour. It's unfair. The life is unfair. So, but with that unfairness, in that 1 hour, what can you do to impress? I'm sure people think about these things. You can record yourself. You can see how is it looking. Would you hire yourself? Ask yourself and see that. So I think those are ways that you can, you know, impress the recruiter.
Okay, the next question is, do you think it's time to go for a higher education and get experience, given that the job scenario is not too great?
Can I take that question?
Yeah, yeah, please.
Yeah. So it's never too late to study. If you want to get higher education, you can get it anytime, and you can also get it along with the job. So if you think you are at that junction in your career where a higher education degree or something is going to help you, and you are getting an opportunity to study, you've got an admission, go for it. But if at all you are, if you need the job at this point and you don't have the resources to, you know, study as much, don't get more into debt is what, as a simple advice, I would say. So that's how I would look at it. But education at any time, I mean, you have to always keep upgrading yourself. So higher education is always a plus. If possible, everyone should. So it's your, there's not like a formula. So for everybody, if you think that it's the right time, go ahead.
I think it's a choice. It's a choice. Honestly, I always, you know, kind of feel I should have, you know, probably, you know, done my master's in one of the IIMs and IITs. And even now I kind of keep thinking, should I still go for it? You'll be surprised to know I did my inter CA and then I did my MBA HR. So even now my dad pushes me saying, why don't you complete your CA? So I don't think you should ever stop learning.
So I'll just share a small example. My sister, she did her PhD and she came home and we were all celebrating and all of that. And my dad says, so now what are you going to study? And we were like, dad, please, like, it's done, no more.
Yeah. I think higher education has also become opportunistic. Like Renita said, it's a very personal thing now. You have to decide what your personal situation is, and does that give you the space, the financial support, and the opportunity to invest? There's no right time to do it. And certainly, I would advise that don't think of the situation we're in as a reason to go to higher education, because you know your life is going to be way beyond what we are experiencing. So think about how higher education plays into your career that's potentially going to last 20, maybe 30 years. I mean, it used to be 30 years, it's slightly lower now, but anything is beyond 20 years. You know, how would you evaluate 6 months or a year in a 20-year long period or a 25-year long period? So think about it, your career in its entirety, and not think about, you know, the 6 months or 8 months that we will struggle with at the moment to make that decision.
Yeah, can I, Manoj?
Yeah, please. I was actually coming to you.
Yeah, so this is regarding higher education. One has to be a little careful on, as Saurabh said, on the career perspective, because what you are now, there could be one career path, but with higher education, there could be a completely a different career path, because in particular, if you look at higher education in core sectors, so then most of the companies for other profiles, for example, coding, developing software, they might think masters in, let us say, mechanical engineering or aerospace engineering. So that's too specialized. So that has to be checked. Okay, so this is a career path. So one has to be careful on that and take it from there based on their interest. So they have to have a combo interest as well as career path. A little bit they have to analyze and then take steps. Yeah.
Okay, great. Okay, now this is a very interesting question. Should I take up a job irrespective of this low salary being offered, given the market condition? I mean, this is for everyone. I think, when you know that the market is like this, people are actually faced with this challenge. Is it, compensation, or is it having a job in hand? What is actually the best situation to be in?
I have already mentioned this is the time to experiment and go for the interest. Okay, instead of agreeing to the pressure by the peers. So don't think of salary or anything. If it interests you, then you take it. Otherwise, you can experiment. So this is the time you can experiment to build up a career in your interest. So that's what I would say.
Great, Professor.
Yeah, that's definitely a fair advice. That said, from the corporate perspective, just because the market is going down or things like this, I would be surprised if any of the organizations really go and lower their salary bands from what they're already announced. I'll be surprised if some of the organizations do that. But if the question, like you said, should I take less money or the job I like, I would always vote for the job you like, because that will take you places. Honestly, at this time of your career, don't worry about the money. It'll come to you. But I know with the peer pressure, that's the first thing. Okay, you got 6 lakhs. I got 7.5 lakhs. So that becomes the thing. But look at some of your seniors who actually gone out of college. Look at their careers in 5 years, what's happened. Whoever probably had taken what they wanted are definitely doing well from the monetary as well as the love for the job that they have. So if I were you, I would really, take up a job that excites me more, and probably in 5 years, I'll be in a better monetary position than my rest of the peer community. And I know the peer pressure is a big one. I can really relate to it, because yesterday the 10th results came and all the kids in the community, the parents were like posting, my son got 91, 92%, and the kids who haven't, I don't know, it's not a good feeling, but well. The peer pressure remains, but it's up for you to stand up to yourself and do the right thing for yourself.
Right. I think I'll add to that, saying, salaries and everything, it is peer pressure, but At the end of the day, what happens now is this salary, but what happens 2 years or 3 years down the line is all up to you. So it's how you take your career ahead. So I don't think salary should be that point. And let me tell you a very open secret. Most organizations who had whatever salaries, there are many organizations who have reduced the salaries also. For people who are interviewing you have also probably got a salary cut. So don't think too much about it. And I like the sentence that Geeta mentioned, that money will come to you. You don't have to go to money. Money comes to you. So
that's reassuring. Saurabh, any thoughts around this?
So I've always really liked this quote that I heard many years ago, that, you know, if you really like what you do, then you will not work a single day in your life. So again, I'm only reiterating what Rita and Geeta have said. Focus on building skills and capability. If you like what you do, you will get better at it. And there was a lovely example I think Geeta gave. Somebody was an executive assistant who was doing a business analyst role. That's what happens when you really enjoy what you do. You will pick up skills. And if you work in, you know, a big energy firm like Emerson, the opportunities are going to be there. Like, you don't have to make an effort to look for jobs. Yes, getting into an organization is a different ballgame, but think about what are the skills that you need to build to get into this. Also, it's very difficult to predict your career path when you're starting off. I think you should focus on investing in experiences, because that will drive where your career is going to be. I mean, I for certain never thought I'll be doing what I'm doing when I started from campus. But yes, I wanted to join an organization where I got interesting work. And I've actually been very fortunate. I've been really lucky that I've had people who invested time, energy, and effort in helping me with my career, right? So if you have good intent and you're intending to learn, I think that's what should be your focus. The rest is all a byproduct of your efforts.
Great. The next question is, of course, it looks a little ambitious given the, you know, situation we are in, but it's interesting. I'm a fresher. What are the career opportunities? I'm looking for jobs abroad. So what are the kind of opportunities which exist for jobs abroad?
Okay.
Are there any career opportunities for freshers abroad? So yeah, so that's the question.
Geeta, you want to take it?
Let go. Okay, I can pick it up. So I think, today the COVID situation is not only for India, right? It is across the world. Probably this is the only thing which has struck the entire world at the same time, leaving the same impact. So the market is going to be, it's not going to be as rosy as it was. But then if that is what you want to aim for and that is something that you aspire for, start doing, you know, putting up your baby steps and probably you'll get there. But again, for, wherever, just not abroad, even if it is in India, for you to land in a job that you want, there is definitely some homework you got to do, understand the organization, talk to some of the people, probably, you know, get coached as to, you know, how are you going to talk? What are the things that you want to, you know, represent about yourself and so on. So according to me, there are no two different ways of looking at a job in India or abroad. It's just about how you channelize your interest and how you reach out to the right people.
Yeah. Great.
The world overall is a small place now, and the information is all available on internet. If you get an opportunity in some place where it's easy to move, go ahead, take that call. I mean, it's all about what your skills are and whether it's matching that organization at the end of the day, whether it is here or any other country. Situation right now is like this, but it's not going to be like this forever. So it's about what choices you make and what kind of role that you can find open at this point of time. It's also important to note, a simple example. For say a finance professional or a marketing professional, if you are a fresher, start reading the annual reports of organizations. within India. If you want to look for a job abroad, then start reading the annual reports of multinational companies or companies which are owned by that country. So by that, you're gaining experience, you're gaining skills, you're gaining the language that you need to use in an interview. So it's how and what you make out of your career, right? So if you are a finance professional, 2 years or 3 years down the line, what does an interviewer want you to do? Or what does your manager want you to do? Try doing that at this point of time. That's going to help in the interview, answering the right questions also.
Great. Any thoughts from Professor?
Yes. So for example, adding to what Geeta and Ramita indicated, for example, if you are looking for a particular specific countries, for example, now Japan is coming in big way. If you are interested, then you should be the first one to pick up some Japanese language training, because they certainly do demand at many places. So these kind of things which you have to analyze and then go for it, and then you should be the first one so that your employability gets enhanced.
Very well said, yeah. Professor. Yeah.
Great.
I think this is a generation where, you know, when you guys pick up anything as well, you do a lot of research, right? Like be it like a gadget that you're picking up, you do a lot of research. And I think I found this generation, the digital natives, to be so good in doing those researches and giving, you know, telling you suggestions as to this, what you should do, apply that for your career. That's it.
I think what anybody thinking about a career abroad should be thinking about is, in reference to what Professor Sir said, think about what is the skill that's not available in that particular geography or jurisdiction that you have that will attract a recruiter or a potential employer to you. I think it's very important to answer. Organizations, again, multinational organizations, I mean, Geeta is one of the largest fintechs in the world. You can apply to any job anywhere. But why, ask yourself, why would a recruiter be interested in looking at your profile? Do you have Japanese skills if you would like to apply for a role in Japan? Just to take Sir's example. If you ask yourself, you know, what are the skills required for me to qualify for a job, then it becomes very easy to know whether it makes sense to apply or not. Because if something is available in the local market, then why would you look at investing the amount of resources to, you know, move somebody from a different geography, especially in economically difficult times that we are in right now or foreseeing for the future?
Great, Saurabh. This again is a very interesting question, and I'm sure a lot of them who are actually starting their professional journey would actually sort of experience this. As a fresher, I generally fumble in my interviews. And how, according to you, I should boost my confidence? I think this is, I mean, all of you can actually take this, because you will actually see this every now and then. So over to you.
So,
everybody wants to rush in here.
Yeah. So, yeah, fumbling in the interview, first thing is ask yourself why you are fumbling in the interview. What is that thing that is making you nervous? Once you know what that is, then you go and do that 5 times or 10 times. So then you get used to that and then it doesn't bother you anymore. I mean, that's my way. Everyone will have their own way of doing it. I'm sure it's a very personal thing about what makes us nervous. Is it a certain personality? Is it a certain environment? Is it your own, what you are wearing and all of that? So it could be different things for different people. So what is it first, if you identify that and you do that 50 times, then it helps. And everybody nowadays has so much network, right? So if you have a sister, a friend, or some mentor that you have who can do a mock interview for you, saying those things that make you nervous more often, you get used to that. And once you practice it, then when you are actually doing the interview, you won't get nervous. I mean, that would be my way of doing it.
So, I mean, I think no, being nervous is just not you guys when you're doing your first interview. I think pretty much a lot of them during the interview or during a session or during a public speaking, I think people go through the emotion. But then it's just about, you know, you'll have to, like Rita said, you'll have to acknowledge what are you comfortable with? You know, what makes you nervous? And if you can identify that, or sometimes just let loose and don't worry about what the environment is, because you definitely know for a fact that you're responding to the right questions and you have all the information in hand. That's one. And two is reflect on when was the last time that you were so comfortable in talking about a topic and relate to that. You know, why were you so comfortable talking about that? And why are you fumbling in an interview? I think that'll give all the answers that you want. It's just about the passion, the confidence that the go-getter attitude. All of that is what really made you to be so passionate about talking on a different topic. So apply that in this interview as well. And let me promise you, none of the interviews are going to swallow you. So, yeah.
And I'll just add one point, Saurabh, if you don't mind, just one
sure.
point here, that all professionals, everyone who looks very confident on stage or, you know, on the screen or, you know, even while giving an interview, at the back on the wings or something, they're all sweating with nervousness. Okay, so nervousness is very natural. In fact, having a little bit of butterflies in the stomach is good omen, they say. And it also ensures you're not overconfident. So don't be scared of nervousness either. Let it happen. It's natural. So Saurabh, sorry, I was
actually going to say, I think Geeta summed it out beautifully, that if you are confident about something, then there is absolutely no reason why, you know, you'll be stuttering or stumbling about it. So you have to find ways to show that confidence. In our days when we were starting, we were encouraged to speak to a mirror. I think everybody's got a phone now. And you can have a WhatsApp call with four of your friends who can actually give you very, very real-time feedback in terms of how you're coming across. So use technology to your advantage. Find those avenues where you can get real-time feedback and you'll be on your way.
I would like to share my experience. This happens actually, but I would tell you most of the interviewers were very kind. And they go a bit informal and they say, yes, if you're nervous, I would ask you to just have a 1 minute walk and then come back. And they would be a little informal with the candidate, a little bit ask some other questions. So I think it's better the candidate opens up with the interviewer that I'm a bit nervous and then what is your suggestion or something. So I think that will help many times. This practically, I have seen it. Yeah.
So if I can, sorry, I can add just one more point on behalf of all the panelists for everybody on this webinar. Recruiters are trying to bring the best out of you. We are interviewing for success or we are evaluating for success. We are not intending to evaluate to highlight your failures. I think if the students or candidates have the same belief that I need to work to put my best foot forward, and I think Sir put it very nicely, call it out. If you're nervous, it's perfectly okay. We are all nervous. You know, I would probably still be nervous. But if you say it out, then it helps the recruiter as well as the candidate balance the conversation, take a break, because we eventually want to succeed, right? We want to hire people. So hope that helps.
I would also sort of let you know that I think more than 2.5 lakh job seekers we've been able to reach through this session on FB. So, I mean, you know, this one and a half hours of interaction, and I'm sure is going to sort of help them because a lot of them are actually starting off their career. And it's been an interesting conversation. And frankly, I mean, a lot of insights have come from both practitioners as well as from professor. I think a lot of them, I mean, you know, starting their career and like what, you know, famously said, Rome was not built in a day. And, you know, all of us have actually spent 15, 20 years and we've seen recessions. We've seen dot-com bursts. We've seen the financial meltdown. And of course, the pandemic. Each of these meltdowns have come with different degrees of challenges. because each of these downturns are very different and very unique. So I think it's very reassuring if, I mean, you know, from what I hear from all of you, I mean, you know, go for it, be positive, remain positive, and wherever there are opportunities, I think invest in learning. I think these are the, you know, the essence of the conversation. And I think remaining positive is also very important for job seekers, because ultimately, I mean, you know, in a working career of about 30, 35 years or 40 years, even if you were to start an enterprise later, I mean, you work for about 30, 35 years. So 1 year is not going to make too much of a difference to anybody's life. So, I mean, you know, I think a lot of insight and I mean, you're sure people who are actually logging in or people who are actually accessing this later also would immensely benefit from the rich experience that all of you have actually shared. Once again, I would like to thank all of you for actually taking time off. And since you're practitioners in the industry or from the industry, your perspective matters a lot. Professor's perspective about how to cope and sort of manage the situation is also very, very important, because a lot of them are actually sort of starting off their career. Probably most of them are freshers, or probably, I mean, you know, are going to pass in 2021. So your perspective of how things would actually play out, all of this is sort of reassuring. At least that's what I could sort of, you know, tell you. So thank you once again for this wonderful session. On a parting note, at least, you know, let me quote what Seneca once famously said. I mean, fire is the test of gold and adversity is a test of men. To add, because there are also a lot of women folks now. So it's basically adversity is also a test of men and women. So I think it's important for us to remain positive, be carriers of positive news. And like what Saurabh rightly said, even this one will pass. So tough times don't last, but tough men and women last. So on that positive note, let me sort of conclude this webinar. And once again, thanking all the panelists, as well as participants